ध्वनिर्वर्णापदं वाक्यमित्यास्पद चतुष्टयम् यस्याः सूक्ष्मादि भेदे वाग्देवीं तामुपास्महे।
संस्कृति और मूल्य।
इलेक्ट्रॉनिक मीडिया प्रोडक्शन एंड रिसर्च सेंटर EMPRC of Madhya Pradesh Bhoj Open University presents its audio lecture series Culture and Value. Friends, in this audio series we presents audio lectures of eminent scholars of culture and value. Today we are going to present the audio lecture of Mrs. Amita Sharma. The topic of her lecture is Culture, Consciousness and Value. The program is recorded, edited and presented by Amar Bahadur Yadav. So let's listen to the audio program Culture, Consciousness and Value.
This lecture has two broad parts. The first sketches the conceptual framework hinging on the two terms culture and value. The second illustrates the assumptions developed in the first part through examples drawn from one specific field of culture, that is literature. Let us first investigate part one, or the conceptual framework. Conceptual framework seeks to set forth the premises on which the meanings of the two terms, culture and value, are constructed. Differences in interpretation of these terms may have deeper ontological and epistemological grounds than just contextual perspectives. Is reality material or spiritual? Is it objectively given or contextually constructed? Is knowledge empirical or a priori or both? Is there a stable objectively given universal self, or the self is under erasure? Is truth universally given and equally cognizable or relative and particularistic? And is it uniformly verifiable with predicable causal patterns or experientially known? Different standpoints on these issues generate different value sets and different definitions of culture. As such, the meanings of these two terms involves the mediation of several other terms, and at least of three key terms: self, consciousness and cognition. Self and consciousness. While the experience of human life is a complex palimpsest that defies neat categories, it would be possible for the purpose of discussion to think of at least two broad ways of understanding the self: as part of a deterministic world of culture, and as that which seeks to create itself in terms that transcend its own deterministic existence as part of nature. These two ways of experiencing the self are necessarily interdependent and are constitutive of human consciousness. As part of a pattern of causal relations, it is to some extent already given, already constituted, and predicated. But it also has a sense of freedom, of not being that which is given. So, one dominant experience of the self is the tension between determinism and freedom. This is linked with the other tension, between the self and the other, the individual and the collective, the particular and the universal. At the empirical level, differences are manifest, emerging from a pluralistic perception of reality managed by forms, codes, functions that tend to be largely contextually determined. But this is only one level of experiencing reality. Within the springs of consciousness is latent the sense of something more than the empirical world. This is the sense of a reality which is not material, which is not part of a causal chain, which is universal, and which is the source of all values. Its meaning, although expressed in historically contingent forms, is neither derived from them nor fully communicated through them. It is self-determinant and self-referent, and yet constitutes the ground for all meanings. It is a sense of unity of all beings. It is not apprehended as being outside. The path of his quest leads inward. While leading inward, it dissolves the difference between the self and the other, unveiling a universal selfhood. Without this idea of universal being, all meanings would diffuse into contingent functions or particularistic interests, eliminating the very possibility of the project of human endeavor to get outside its given situation, to choose and act with freedom and creativity. Wedged between these two forms of experiences, caught between conflicting impulses, the self struggles to understand its true nature. This struggle is at the core of search for all meanings. Human consciousness is quintessentially this search for selfhood. Since it is the self seeking to know itself, this becomes a process of self-consciousness. Now let us see what is value. For functional purposes again, it is possible to think of three ways in which consciousness evaluates experience, constructs values: aesthetical, ethical, pragmatic. Value can be broadly described as a triad of beauty, goodness, and practical function. The search for truth is the process for integrating the apprehension of different experiences in a union, suggesting that differently apprehended values are fundamentally one. At the deepest level of our consciousness, there is a need to satisfy the aesthetic, ethical, and pragmatic urges fully, in a holistic manner, rather than at the cost of each other. The mutually embedded nature of beauty, utility, and goodness is perhaps best illustrated in the contemporary anxiety over ecology. So long as nature is seen only as a physical resource apart from man, and man himself is seen in atomistic, individualistic terms, nature shall continue to be exploited by man. And this itself will be a part of man's exploitation of man. The ecological angst is the result of the rupture of the self into particularistic dichotomous identities and the tendency of each part to see itself as a whole. This disharmony expresses itself vividly as loss of beauty, diminishing utility, and loss of self. Unfortunately, in the context of human interactions, despite moments of experience of universal selfhood, the seduction of purely formalistic beauty or the substantial advantages of calculated self-interest, both the exaggeration of a part into whole can often obscure the realization that unethical choices are ugly and doomed. A realization that had been dramatically etched in Oscar Wilde's picture of Dorian Gray and Stevenson, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Thus, the three values, beauty, goodness, and pragmatic function, are necessarily related to each other, and the discovery of this necessary interdependence constitutes the process of self-consciousness. Now let's see what is cognition, what the cognitive process involves. Cognition is through the reciprocal processes of reason and imagination. Once it is recognized that truth is not just that which is empirically verifiable, but includes that which need not be grounded on an external referent, then cognitive processes do not have to have a sequential progress from sensory data to ideational constructions. Instead, it is possible to apprehend meaningful forms autonomously. This autonomy of the mind to discover, create, affirm meaning can be described as the power of intuition. The premise here is that intuition is a form of cognition. In fact, the absolute ground for all cognitive processes. Not being determined by the sensory world, it is the faculty for apprehending transcendental reality. Not limited by empirical categories, intuition becomes the capacity of recognizing the universal nature of the self and the unity of all values as one truth. Let us come to the question of the relation between value and culture. Value construction is thus intrinsic to the nature of consciousness. What is the relationship that this inherent process of consciousness has with culture? It can be seen as an interactive process between the self and the world. To an extent, the process of value apprehension inherent to the consciousness projects itself onto the world around, and processes that have crystallized and assumed objective forms constituting a system turn around and influence the self. Value seeking is at the individual and collective level, constituting a system turn around and influence the self. Value seeking is at the individual and collective level. It has an atemporal character but are realized through a temporal process. The ability to discriminate between the particular and contingent and the universal is central to an inquiry into the nature of values. This inquiry is partly determined by culture. This requires an elucidation of the term culture. Now let us see what we mean by culture. Culture has a formal and an informal aspect to it. It is expressed both through the formal institutions and covenants that people set up to regulate their activities and the informal logic that they live by. Since culture is about the way people are and seek to be, it has been variously theorized. Culture has been regarded as an epiphenomena of external material processes or an autonomous realm with its own internal logic and properties. Its structure and forms have been linked to specific social and historical contexts, and at the same time, it has been seen as constitutive of a universal core of values, enabling normative integration. Culture tends to get identified with collective symbols, rituals, and representations, or with the whole way of life, where the border between culture and society are blurred. Culture has been seen in the sense of a great tradition or dialogic, critical, subversive, linked with everyday life and struggles. What does emerge is the inclusive, composite nature of culture that involves ideals and norms, institutions and practices, production processes and representative forms, situated in specific contexts but whose meaning can transcend those contexts to link with a larger quest for meaning. The significance of culture thus is at two levels, empirical and historical and transcendental. At both levels, culture is a search for values expressing themselves through diverse forms located in specific contexts. But these forms acquire meaning not just as derived from their context, but from their capacity to generate meanings that resonate universally. Culture thus becomes an activity of the consciousness. Its significance lies in its process, for while its expressive forms keep changing in accordance with the changes in modes of communication, customs, norms, its power lies in dialectical interplay of ideas. Culture thus is not static. Intrinsic to culture are processes of change, creating a dynamics of identity and values. The knowledge imposes a pattern and falsifies, for the pattern is new in every moment. And every moment is a new and shocking valuation of all we have been. There is an inherent process of identification, selection, validation, redefinition that makes culture a living force fraught with tensions, aspirations, and an internal questioning. This internal self-reflexive process can be spontaneous or consciously structured, suppressed or supported, but it is intrinsic to every culture. It may lead to reinforcing existing norms, modifying or moving away from them. Culture thus is not a passive conformity to forms. Its vibrant impulse is in critical consciousness or self-reflexiveness, which expresses itself through diverse modes, aesthetic, symbolic and material. The reduction of culture to just its material forms, the exhibit approach or a particular set of practices, the ethnic approach, is the result of voiding the form, product or artifact of their ideational significance. Just as shrinking the interplay of diverse factors to a particular set of ideas as the ideological force of culture is the result of isolating a part and regarding it as a whole. It is tempting to think of the process of culture as construction of knowledge, which at the phenomenological level is knowledge of the world, but which itself has meaning if it is informed by a search for meaning of the self. The character of such knowledge is defined by its ethical content, its concern for humanity, its search for shared selfhood. It is the ethical content that transforms the instrumental nature of knowledge into intrinsic good, transforming it from a resource into value. Such knowledge is not esoteric, but the pulse of daily life and its ordinary struggles. Culture, perceived as the process towards self-consciousness, counters the tendency to classify culture into the high and the low, the exclusive and the uninitiated. Empirical attributes can mediate the process of culture, but these cannot become categories of definition because culture derives its energy from the self's restless surge towards seeking and expressing its meaning. This itself implies an impulse to break the borders that are given. Culture, as a process towards the self-consciousness, becomes a project of universal participation. The ultimate democracy and the ground for the equality of all persons. The understanding of human life as a condition that is improved with an improvement in the production and distribution of material resources will continue to be plagued by contradictions of self-interest and newer forms of inequalities unless it acknowledges the idea of the self as a universal ethical consciousness. Understood thus, culture becomes the domain where individual will and collective good can reconcile. Because of the perception of the self as universal and not because of a complicated calculus of interests. Cultural studies are usually conducted to point out significant differences of contexts in order to vigorously protest against generalizations. The argument here is that an inquiry into value, as different from an inquiry into fact, by its very nature, seeks the universal in the particular as imaging the universal, and does not see them as binaries. Culture derives its contemporary force and relevance from the dialogue it seeks to weave between the past and the present, between different voices seeking to establish identity in the present, responsive to others. One of its most expressive forms is literature. Now let us come to the question of literature and value. Literature is distinct because in its representation of human consciousness, it is concerned with relating the particular and the universal, the subjective and the objective. The aesthetic image in literature has the unique character of being, as Croce described it, as concrete universal. This image has vivid palpable reality and the immediacy of something happening in experiential time. The imaginative rendering of emotion creates a blend of the particular and the universal that has experiential intensity and disinterestedness. As Aquinas said, integritas, that is wholeness, consonantia, that is sense of internal harmony, interrelation of parts, claritas, that is force of generalization that transcends particular, spiritual force, enchantment of the heart. Aquinas says, three things are needed for beauty, wholeness, harmony and radiance. The first phase of apprehension is a bounding line drawn about the object to be apprehended. An aesthetic image is presented to us either in space or in time. What is audible is presented in time, what is visible is presented in space. But, temporal or spatial, the aesthetic image is first luminously apprehended as self-bounded and self-contained upon the immeasurable background of space or time which is not it. You apprehended it as one thing. You see it as one whole. You apprehend its wholeness, that is ingritas. The synthesis of immediate perception is followed by the analysis of apprehension. Having first felt that it is one thing, you feel now that it is a thing. You apprehend it as complex, multiple, divisible, separable, made up of its parts, the result of its parts and their sum harmonious, that is consonantia. What is claritas? He might mean that claritas is the artistic discovery and representation of the divine purpose in anything or force of generalization which would make the aesthetic image a universal one, make it outshine its proper conditions. Quality of meditation and rapture, different from philosophical reflection or spiritual wisdom which seeks to abnegate emotion. Consider the famous soliloquy of Hamlet, to be or not to be. This raises the fundamental questions of human condition that are fit subject of religion or metaphysics. This is the distinct quality of literature. It does not just reflect the nature of consciousness, but it transforms consciousness. We experience a qualitatively different kind of being, at least for the time the aesthetic image stays with us. For that moment, the self becomes both subjective and objective. As suggested before, the object seen and subjective seer, or as Yeats put it, both the dancer and the dance. This can be described as empathy, the capacity to feel subjectively and at the same time to apprise objectively. Keats described this as negative capability, where the mind enters the object seen and so becomes the subject, and at the same time remains the seer. Thus, transformation of familiar reality into an image becomes the vehicle for the transformation of the empirical self into the universal self. The process of transformation can be described as recognition, alienation, and recognition. There is initial identification as recognition of something familiar in our lives. But with the absorption of self in the aesthetic image occurs the process of distancing from our personal contingent self. The aesthetic image is the medium for this distancing the self and recognition. This turning around to look at ourselves in a recognition even more significant, as it recognizes that the truth in our daily lives about ourselves and the world is illusory, and that the truth about ourselves is as imaged in fiction. A metaphysical truth, that is our real life situation, one may be unable to see. A metaphysical truth that in our real life situation one may be unable to see. This metaphysical truth of ourself may be variously interpreted by different writers. But what is interesting is that in most of them, the process of perceiving this truth is a process of alienation and recognition. The most striking example of this is in Sartre's Nausea, that begins with the protagonist's sense of giddiness and bewilderment upon looking at himself in the mirror, signifying the estrangement from himself. In Sartre, the self is imprisoned in a historically given condition and freedom and love to remain in illusions. However, the recognition of this illusion constitutes freedom. Freedom from illusion and choosing to act in the knowledge that the freedom chose is itself an illusion, is an act of courage and liberation. Estrangement is the mode of self-recognition and so of freedom. A very different image of self is apprehended in the romantic poetry, of which the most representative is Wordsworth. In Wordsworth, childhood is a stage of complete identification of the self with its transcendental nature, that is seen to be pure and joyous. The process of growing up is a growing away from spontaneous selfhood, which the incrustations of the material world tell the mind in a moment of intuition disengages itself from its empirical self and has intimations of its immortality. Estrangement here is both negative and positive, a loss of and reclaiming of identity. Eliot's main theme has been death in life and life in death. April is the cruelest month, bringing lilacs into the dead land, stirring dull roots with spring rain. Winter kept us warm. Losing ourselves in the materialist world of desires is an acceptable form of existence, and detaching ourselves from it is pain. Death and life are inverted to indicate the death of ego that is necessary for the re-emergence of the self, which in its desireless state achieves liberation, transcending the contradictions of this world. In contemporary times, Sitji's writings stand out their concern for probing into the nature of human values. His writings render the ruthless images of strife-torn colonized Africa into a universal allegory of self-consciousness experienced through alienation, self-denial, and acceptance. Decolonization becomes the effort not just to move out of a historically fixed, externally defined identity. It is an exfoliation of the existentially trapped self to discover the rock bottom. The powerful, unbearable sense of humiliation and suffering that are the dominant emotion in disgrace, waiting for the barbarians and life and times of Michael, induce an experientially intense emotional response that crystallizes as metaphor of the state of being. Colonization by an external agency becomes both the occasion and the symbol of displacement of identity. But the suffering, the disgrace that it causes, compels a remaking of the self in a manner that is more meaningful. The trajectory of experience goes through rejection and humiliation and excruciating suffering towards the acceptance of that suffering through self-denial and refusal to explain and justify either to the world or to oneself, coming to terms with a self that is forged through negation of all externally imposed attributes in a manner almost akin to neti-neti. In that completely erased self, symbolized through social ostracization in disgrace and barbarity, and through social and physical self-exclusion, in the sense of non-being, is the affirmation of being without definitions. Aesthetic image. The power of art to disturb and displace our ordinary perception of reality and to compel us to look beyond what appears, even while the mode of seeking this deeper truth are forms of illusion themselves, is a recurrent observation in Shakespeare. For Eliot, creativity has the power of transcendental recognition. This is best articulated by Coleridge. Biographia Literaria, Chapter 5-9, in Coleridge Imagination. Primary imagination, according to him, is repetition in the finite mind of eternal act of creation in the infinite I am. Literature, more than any art form, because it represents human life, has to negotiate the issue of moral consciousness. Literature also demonstrates more effectively how the aesthetic consciousness is related to moral consciousness. The key to understanding is the need to see holistically. It is the sense of the whole that creates both aesthetic and moral consciousness. Moral issues relate to the way in which individual will and freedom can coexist with obligations towards each other. The ground for their resolution lies in the postulate of a universal self that is realizable through the acceptance of a set of values and norms. The concept of freedom is void without this moral context. Negotiation between self and the world is literature's central concern. Emotional intensity is because of this pervasive moral concern. Conflict, choice, freedom, determinism, all these themes, empathic understanding, subject-objective state enables this. The crucial role of literature in enlarging and understanding to be able to take our judgments beyond merely conventional custom and practice to respond to the universal springs of human action. In this kind of empathic understanding, embedded in moral consciousness, lies the power of works like Crime and Punishment, Anna Karenina, Lord Jim, and The Heart of Darkness or Macbeth, where the protagonist has committed a wrong consciously and suffers for it. The sense of wholeness, the feeling that is could not be otherwise, is a feeling simultaneously aesthetic and ethical. The interrelationship between parts to form a whole is both an aesthetic and an ethical value. The objective correlative images human action. Its aesthetic quality derives from the way its formal and emotional constituents express an ethical vision. And this communicates a sense of wholeness and clarity, which is claritas. The crisis in this internal connection is both aesthetic and ethical failure. Thus, the cause-effect structure of the narrative, that is, its aesthetic logic and its moral logic, are intertwined. In fact, it is the distancing image of the imaginative image that enables a deeply empathic, ethical vision that is profounder than the narrowly judgmental or conventionally moral response. Joyce has an interesting observation on art and pornography. The arts which excite them, pornographical or didactic, are therefore improper arts. The aesthetic emotion, I use the general term, is therefore static. The mind is arrested and raised above desire and loathing. The impersonal nature of art induces a spiritual state as beautiful as what Shelley called the enchantment of the heart. Seeing things as they are is seeing an infinite possibilities of things that are finite and imperfect, creates an experience both aesthetically moving and ethically satisfying. Beauty is truth, truth beauty, that is all you know and all you need to know. This creative nature of language, its capacity to give form to experience, to give significance to values that may get suppressed by functional needs of our practical existence, literature becomes the mode of self-consciousness. Having said this, I need to say that Elizabeth Costello says, "The word mirror is broken. There used to be a time when we could say who we are. Now, we are just performers speaking our parts. The bottom has dropped out, but we could think of this as a tragic turn of events, were it not that it is hard to have respect for whatever it was that dropped out. It looks to us like an illusion now, one of those illusions sustained only be the concentrated gaze of everyone in the room. Remove your gaze for but an instant, and the mirror falls to the floor and shatters. All is allegory. The denial presupposes a denier. Particular forms would dissipate into meaninglessness. Without a consent assumed outside and beyond them, which, notwithstanding its functional nature, acts as a referent. The leveling of all forms into one flat surface is perhaps the most dangerous of all suggestions. The celebration of differences and then the submergence of differences in an equal valuelessness is a form of subversion that defeats the very project of humanity. What it does is to reduce consciousness to sensation, idea to image. Creativity gives way to mimesis, subjectivity to objects. Rational discrimination is replaced by desire. All is reduced to an equal level of trivia, which is then apotheosized into a cult. The effect of this flux of image sensation becomes a form of colonization through desire. Since communication, technology, pastiche and pervasive, the control of communication resources in control of those with power, this becomes an unrestrained reign of materialism. At the end, we can say that paradoxically enough, this very denial of the self, this erosion of consciousness into viscera of images, becomes the strongest reason for literature as keeping alive a critique of human life.
You are listening to the audio program series Culture and Value. You have just heard the audio lecture on the topic Culture, Consciousness and Value. The subject expert was Mrs. Amita Sharma. Narrator was Dr. Sushmita Pandey and announcer was Kaushal Sharma. The program was recorded, edited and presented by Amar Bahadur Yadav. This audio program was produced by Electronic Media Production and Research Center, EMPRC, of Madhya Pradesh Bhoj Open University.